where they're entering from.
Southern Recognition. I don't know if you have seen
So many great coaches, administrators, and athletes have been honored in this hall for their contributions to high school athletics in the state of North Carolina. It is a proud tradition that the NCHSA carries, and it is proud because of the great people from Dr. Armin Armstrong to Simon Terrell, Charlie Adams, Gary McGee, and so many more that have been honored on a night just like this, that have been dedicated to the standard of excellence that the NCHSA is coming known for across this state and this country. Before we move on any further, at this time I'd like to welcome Rick Strunk to join me on the stage. Rick is a fellow Tar Heel, class of 1975, just in Morgan, and former Associate Commissioner of Communications for North Carolina High School Athletics Association. He is also a member of our Hall of Fame from the class of 2014, where he's nearly 4 years of service in high school sports in our state. Mr. Strunk is going to help us conduct some interviews on stage this evening. The time now has come to meet the members of the class of 2023 in the North Carolina High School Athletic Association Hall of Fame. Our first honoree this evening will enter the hall posthumously, EA Spike Corbin. Coach Corbin is one of two inductees entering this evening after their death as he passed away in 2003 at the age of 89. Coach Corbin was one of the pioneers of integration and a highly successful coach in the North Carolina High School Athletic Conference prior to the integration of the association to North Carolina in the 60s. Coach Corbin served as head football, basketball, and baseball coach at Wilson Senior High in Wilmington from 1948 until integration in 1968. His teams won NCHSAC championships in all three sports, including all three in the same year in 1955. He moved on to become assistant principal at Harvard, where they also won state championship in 1972. From 1975 to 1980, Corbin served as director of health, PE, and athletics for the New Hanover Board of Education. We prepared a short video honoring Coach Corbin this year.
The North Carolina High School Athletic Association Hall of Fame is proud to induct EA Spike Corbin. Originally from Massachusetts, Coach Corbin became a legend in the world. At Wilson Senior High School, Coach Corbin led seven different teams to state championships, two in football, two in baseball, and three in basketball. In 1965, he won all three. In 1968, Coach Corbin moved to Harvard High School and won another baseball state championship there in 1972. The baseball field at Harvard High now bears his name. He was named North Carolina State Baseball Coach of the Year five different times, 1965, 68, 72, 74, and 75. Coach Corbin was named Wilmington's Citizen of the Year in 1967. He has since been inducted into the Greater Wilmington Sports Hall of Fame and the North Carolina Athletic Records Association Hall of Fame. Coach Corbin coached five different baseball players and went on to play in the major leagues, as well as tennis great Althea Gibson and famous world-timer Medalar Lemon. Coach Corbin was just as impactful off the field as he was on it. He was a champion of the integration process in Wilmington Public Schools. He also served as assistant principal and New Hanover County Athletic Director. He was a syndicated cartoonist and, in the past, even wrote the Harvard High School fight song. The NCHSAA Hall of Fame is honored to include PA Spike Porter in the class of 2020.
Coach Porter is represented by James Baldwin this evening. Thank you. Can you stand for us? All right. Thank you, Jamie. This time I'd like to invite Ms. Judy Brenner to the stage. Tonight we honor her late husband, Rich. He passed away in 2012 at the age of 65. He was originally from Philadelphia and served as a television sports anchor for 34 years. He spent 21 years in the Triad, serving the local community in Highland and surrounding area with Fox 8. Brenner was a highly decorated sportscaster, winning three Southeastern Regional Emmys and a host of other awards, including Virginia Sportscaster of the Year in 1978. He was honored by the North Carolina Youth Soccer Association for outstanding soccer coverage in 1991, and inducted into the Guilford County Sports Hall of Fame in 2012. He collected the Silver Circle and the National Iris Award from the National Association of Television Program Executives for local TV programming excellence, including his Friday Night Football highlight show. Despite his passing, his legacy lives on in a pair of scholarships, one awarded each year to a member of the UNCG Women's Tennis Team, and the other was awarded by the Oregon Harry Ball Chapter of the National Football Foundation each year for outstanding community leadership. At this time, I'd like to direct your attention to a series for a short video. The North Carolina High School Athletic Association.
Well, when he called me that morning, I started crying. But my kids were like, "What? Are you serious?" It's just, they just felt very blessed and happy for him. He was in the Marine Corps. Between his junior and sophomore year of college, he went to Vietnam as a collegiate correspondent to cover the war. And it really impacted him. He always wanted to be a Marine, but even more so when he got back from Vietnam. While he was in Vietnam, he met a brand new cub reporter from ABC named Ted Koppel. And Ted Koppel said to him, "Son, you're going to get yourself killed, so you follow me around." So Rich was just happy to do that. And many years later, we were in Chicago, Ted Koppel happened to be at Concord. And introduced himself and he went, "No, I remember who you are. I thought you'd be dead by now." But anyway, so after he came back from Vietnam and he went to college, he joined the Marine Corps, and he just really loved doing things for the veterans and the community. He loved when kids, especially at high school age, would come up to him and ask him about health care. How to get into broadcasting, and he would be one of the first to say, "Hey, come follow me one day." And sometimes he would issue those kinds of challenges to the kids in the local area and say, "Hey, come follow me for a day if you want to know what I do." It wasn't easy being a sports broadcaster. But they thought if you showed up 10 minutes earlier, that was your job, when in reality it was from 1:30 until 1:30 the next Sunday. Many people don't know how funny he was. He was absolutely hilarious. He was very much a motivator, even though he covered lots and lots of events that he couldn't be at his own terms. Banquets, games, things like that. You make those sacrifices for people. And it's that expensive. But he made those. So I remember one time there, our daughter's soccer banquet, she was getting all the special awards, and he had to, in order to make a banquet, do the live shot from there. So he did the live shot, and he expressed those sacrifices that he made, that sometimes he covered other parents' children's banquets more than him. His own shoulders. And then he began to get a little emotional and started to cry. But it came through about Vicente soon, because Vicente was there. And I think everybody understood that he got a lot of family and was saying, okay, we all got to take the process. You know, we all make sacrifices for our children, thinking of our
TV. That's not very average. But can you hear about students calling him?
so that he believed that.
I think he treated everyone special. He had this knack for making people, when he was speaking to them, believe that they were the only person in a room of 1,000 people. And he treated people, everyone, from the owner of the team down to the concession worker, the very same. And I think that's what made him a fan favorite, was the respect that he gave to everyone that he met.
And that's part of the reason he got into the North Carolina High School Association, a Hall of Fame. Judy Brenner, Richard Brenner, Judy, thank you so much.
On the sidelines
it really changed things. I mean, I do think that our ourselves are planning really what we're going to do. I keep my plans for the year, right? And like other parents said, we got to make sure that I tell them that the team is easy, but stay on the team and be at practice because in all those years that I coached, I only had to do 2 10-5 players from the team because they missed any practice. So that very seldom missed practice. And that don't make it the day before that I played again next week. Years ago, I remember I had a team that was 6 shot. We lost the game, and they just obeyed on Coach Ferguson. It's what we call, I call them mistress, they all call suicide people. But they want to do all these random things, and they're good survivors today. So, I mean, I've incorporated a lot of things that I've changed. I've incorporated a lot of my conditioning and running drills with basketball skills. That way, I'm getting conditioned, but also getting some improvement in basketball skills. So I do a lot of conditioning with basketball skills. I say my gym team would be proud because he nominated me at the end of the year. Because he helped me with the children. He's always saying, we haven't been here yet. I said nothing. In fact, when he first started talking about it, I said, well, probably got me nominated for him. Unfortunately, he passed away before I could. Now, he told me I could tell my family members, so I told my husband, then I told my two sons, my children.
Said the run was safe, the mic was on. You mentioned the video, how you've adjusted some of the coaching techniques over the years. And also, women have a lot more opportunity now than they did when you were starting. But how have you seen the actual game of women's basketball change from the time you were playing until today? What are the major differences?
Well, when I played, we had 6 on the court. There were 2 stationary forwards and 2 stationary guards.
I think there might be a few people that saw a 6-person basketball game or something. There are a few not so good. Okay?
Well, I had the advantage when I played with 6 men that I was a roving guard, which meant I played offense and defense. So when I went my first year, it was Atlantic Christian then. When I went and played there for them, Carol Hill was my coach. We got my first introduction to 5-man basketball. And so, because I had played offense and defense, that was certainly an advantage for me. Except, of course, when we practiced in high school, it was always 4. And we know so soon we passed away because y'all said 2 people down the way before we got there. So, sort of too many games involved. Also, the young in middle school, they went to free dribble. Prior to that, they only dribbled 3 times. And I think my mom's here, and they dribbled once. And they don't teach young dribble once. If you go dribble once, you know that's someone with you. when I went to middle school, they went free dribble. And that's what I loved to do, dribble. I was a point guard, and I loved it. And we could win if you go back to it. I remember a couple of high school games. I killed 2 minutes off the clock, running around back and forth, chasing me, just trying to keep this driving and kill the clock, that kind of thing. So it was different, but, you know, I also played with boys basketball. And that didn't start to change until 1984 was the first year of small basketball. Pam and Phyllis Forbes, they're that first group I believe that played in small basketball. I think if we had had small basketball back in the early 80s, I believe our 15s would have done it. Pam and Phyllis were not able to shoot 3 points. We'll get 3 points.
and also Dan has changed a lot and changed with it. I'm curious because when you were coming up there weren't many role models of female coaches or even ADs. How did you decide to become a coach? How did that work for you?
My high school, middle school and high school coach, Willis Season, made him fun. He inspired us to play basketball. And, you know, you still get an average coach, I don't care what you love. And he said, oh, gosh, that reassured me that we love Norman. And, you know, Rick Smith is a new, he probably remembers Willis Season. So I'm not really coach, but yeah, Willis inspired me. And for many, many years, he followed me and was my mentor and encouraged me, you know, and so forth. But I got a lot of my coaching style, a lot of things I think from him.
Of course, as the video said, they have 20 years for these long time coach, outstanding AD. What's the challenge of coaching a team in Holland that you did as a women's basketball coach and also directing a sports program for 26 sports on Southwest?
Time management is very important. Also, surround yourself with good people. Got somebody here, Delphine Mabry, who was involved. And it's my sister, A.D., my son, Shelton Langley. They helped me a lot of times. That's like my sister, A.D., and did a lot of things for me. I think also having people, surround yourself with good people and loyal people. I think that's important. And knowing how to treat people. I do a lot of things for you. I mean, they're a big rock for you sometimes. You know how to treat people. And I know in my athletic camp, so I worked with them for several years. I was the chairperson of the athletic camp, which is like a good 12. I'm still doing that now as volunteering. But treating those people a lot too. With concession folks, they can feel special for it. And they are, because you cannot run a program by yourself. You've got to have other people to help you.
All those things come together in this honor. Now I'm a member of the North Carolina High School Association Hall of Fame, Sandra Lane.
Thank you. very awesome. My life has been wonderful, and I appreciate coaching and did the remember. I'm proud to have coached in the HBS All-Star game, and I was one of the coaches in the last North South game in the ring. And I can't tell you, I had some wonderful young men in the first game, and I will never forget what the late transfer did to the coach of East Carolina City. I was in the Methodist class at East Carolina my senior year, and the professor was saying, teach them this, teach them that. Coach Sassovitz stuck his head in the door and said, you don't teach them, you run. And I really get that. And I never wanted to see or hear a young man or woman say, Coach, I don't know what to do. I want them prepared for whatever they come in the game. I can't even imagine the times that I bought this student's insurance so they could put it out of my pocket. And you drove the activity list, you saw it at the cops. If they didn't have money, you made sure they got something to give. Those are the things that you give them every day. But the good thing is, your players work. Many of my football players got out of the pickup truck, the back of them on their hands, shot at their fullback to San Alfred and play football. They were just tough. And we didn't have great programs those days because they worked. I told the people there to tell a story today, but I was an infant. When I was young, no question about it. Red-headed, double face, ugly, white, my collar, you know. And somewhere along the line, I developed some comments. I think Coach did. And changed my life in time. I'm proud of that. And I had some people to work hard on this. And they told me who did it. Dr. Miller, he introduced me one night as a Hall of Fame coach. I said, nope, I am not a Hall of Fame coach. Some of my former players were 3 years ago, and they went to work. And this is a great part that came about, and I'm proud of it.
No room to say, this is a hot seat, it's not really hot, so don't worry. I'm always curious, people go from diverse backgrounds to become coaches. How did you first get involved? What led you to make the decision to become a coach?
Well, I decided my senior year in high school that the best way for me to interact with all the young men around me was to be a coach and a teacher.
And I was able to do that over a long period of time in different sports. You mentioned a video that coaching helped you develop confidence. And I'm curious, how did that occur? How did coaching act? How did you develop confidence as a coach?
Well, I think all coaches would say, win your confidence. I remember who said this. You show me a good loser, and I'll show you a loser. Or the great gift from God. I believe in that whole heart. I believe in discipline and hard work. And I've always considered myself a hard worker, and I believe that you can behave yourself if you can't do anything else. And that's what I really believe.
The video mentioned 22 coaches a year, state championship. When you reflect on your career there, what are some of your fondest memories? And it might not be a championship, what are a couple of fond memories you have as a coach?
Well, believe it or not, one of the fondest memories I have was when we didn't win. We were playing the state championship in 2 out of 3 series. On Friday night, we won, there were 17 innings, and we won 1-0. Both pitchers pitched all 17 innings. We had to play a third game on Monday night, and both pitchers came back and pitched again. And some of my former players said, Coach, you won't put in the Hall of Fame because you worked the pitcher today. I'll never forget, that was one of the fondest memories I had. And we lost the series, but many good things.
things that happened since then. But the first one, as it ran, in 1967, the state baseball championship, my was the best of all time.
And if you want to validate what Nolan said, look at the NCAA baseball record book and you'll see those pitching performances recorded in there. Now, you coached some smaller schools during your career and a number of different sports. What would you say are some of the benefits of being in a small school and some of the challenges with fewer athletes and coaches?
Well, benefits of small school, you get to know, I learned as a player what his parents are with. And sometimes you can have some parents that push you pretty hard. I had one time when I was coaching football, he sat behind me at every game and tried to tell me what to do, what play to run. So one night we played the last game of the season, fourth and goal on 1 yard line for the conference championship. My quarterback, I called timeout, he came over to the bench and said, "Coach, what can I run?" I scratched my bald head and I said, "I don't know, but I'll find out." I turned around and asked him, "What can I run?" He said, "I got you this far, now you won't run."
And as an officer in that organization for 3 years. Kids off the ball with these little prints and strings.
beautiful. And that's why our school is so beautiful. It's really a good place and do what we do.
And by the way, that was the bragging you did, because the great philosopher Disney said they bragged to prove it. And I think those stats kind of prove it. Now, you've seen a lot of football games in your career. And I'm always intrigued by, I've asked the question of other coaches. Can you recall one of the funniest or most unusual things you've ever seen happen in a high school football game?
Right.
And we went down after the years rolling.
this time I'd like to invite Coach Bailey to the stage. Coach David Gentry is the winningest coach in the history of North Carolina High School football, North Carolina High School Athletic Association football. He wins. He compiled a record of 426 wins and winning over 5 losses in 3 times over 47 years of coaching. His record at Murphy alone was impressive, having won 361 games, losing 117, and tying just one time. That also was the NCAA record for the most wins at a single school. Gentry's teams won 9 state championships and finished as runner-up 3 more times. He collected 18 conference championships in the highly competitive Smoky Mountain Conference, and was named Conference Coach of the Year 18 times as well. In 2017, he was the head coach of the Shrine Bowl team. He was honored as one of the NCHSA's 100 coaches to remember in our centennial celebration in 2013, and he has been inducted into the Western North Carolina Sports Hall of Fame in 2017. The football field at Murphy is named in his honor.
Good. there. And you never know the, what lives you touch. What I have seen, what I have known that people come to me, I've really felt like that maybe I've done something in this life that will be a positive influence on kids. You know, as far as you know, the way you discipline them, the way you talk to them, the way you handle them, the way you love them, and they come out to be great people. You know, my urologist is my quarterback. You get to those places where everybody around you, where Gary Murphy is a big thing. You know, we've been here so long. A lot of these people in town and around, doctors and lawyers and Indian chiefs are came up in our program. That's something to be very proud of.
Congratulations. In the video, you mentioned the influence of another great coach, Red Wilson. What sorts of things did you learn while playing for him that carried over to your own program when you became a head coach?
Well, I didn't really play for Red. I was an undergraduate assistant to him for 2 years. I coached for him. And so I was able to learn a lot more in coaching than I was really playing. And Red, I don't know how many people know Red Wilson, but he's a legend at Elon, Duke University, and raised a lot of money for him. One thing I learned from Red was the psychological way to motivate kids. He was a psychology major. And he could motivate kids without really running them a lot. So I learned how to motivate kids without really punishing them or doing things for them. And that was a great start in my career. Red was real good at that, motivating his kids and getting his kids ready to play. And the mental aspect of playing is just as important as the physical aspect. If you can get a kid mentally ready, then you're pretty well going to have him ready for.
Obviously, your stats are staggering, 426 victories, 361 adversity, and in the video you kind of alluded to the closeness of the community feels with the program. What would you say makes Murphy such a great place to coach at and kind of live in?
Well, it's a small town, and just like the boys up in Smoke, all of the towns in West North Carolina probably used to go small. So you feel like we are emphasized family. You know, we're a family, and family is a big thing for us. So the town, the community, the school was more of a family thing, and we really try to emphasize the family aspect, that we are family, and we're going to protect that family. We're going to work hard for our family, not let it go away. And, you know, always the family's going to get that for you. And that's what you tell your kids. And so, and that's what I think we believe in our kids. And they've got their hope that they're a real family. So, I think that's a real big asset. And you go down the hall, you knew everybody, at school. I taught all the boys in school. So, I mean, that's an asset. You get to know everybody in that school. And it was a bit extra positive in the middle of school. I think 150 years. That was a good size for me.
Did you coach fathers and later their sons?
Oh, yeah. State champion. Father and son. I've got them in here. I coached your father. Coached your son. And they're really easy to do that. I mean, you know, what they expect when they come to you, they've already been taught. All you got to do is get on the bus tonight and tell them to show up.
You know, probably nobody is better qualified to answer this question than you are. 9 state championships, probably for 12. So what does it take for a school to win a state football championship.
It's like Coach Pete said, and Coach Pete's in the room, and that's a legend in itself, just out of Bobby. But what it takes, I think you've got to get your kids doing their best. I think any team, most of the teams that I think Murphy plays, they're going that I coach, they play their hardest, they play their best. And their best is always going to be good. It's always going to be, where you win, lose, or drop, your best is always going to be good. But you don't need anything less than your best is not good. And I always tell my kids, before we go play, on Friday or Thursday, we were talking to them, I said, I want you to be able to get up on Saturday morning and look in that mirror and say, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of the way you play. I'm proud of you. Yeah. If you can do that, we're going to be all right. We're going to win some conference championship, and every once in a while, we're going to be swimming.
I'm going to give you a shot at this question, and I pray that it's not when you've got a jacket, you don't got a jacket. But for you, what's the most unusual thing that you've seen happen in high school football?
I don't know. I'm not perfect. It's a long way, like Coach Pete says, from Berkeley to Chapel Hill. And I've flown down to two or three press conferences in Murphy. You remember? And people know it. They don't realize I can go to six state championships, six state capitals, Berkeley and I can go to all.
Don't tell my wife that.
Yeah, I'm right. Four championships, six. What was odd about one thing is on the way back to me and my wife and she it was great. And any coach out here will tell you, your spouse, how great your wives are to be of a coach's wife, a coach's spouse. It takes a lot of dedication. It takes a and I appreciate that. And I want you to everybody out here to appreciate your wives and your spouse. But we scheduled, my wife was scheduled everything, the motels, us getting on the motels, we got to do all that stuff. And I talked to the bus guy, and I said, okay, I'm going to get out on Friday morning, go play Saturday or whatever. And I woke up, I got everything else, and had a lot of things going on during the state championship. Got up on Friday morning at 6 o'clock, a little before we leave at 7:30, and I realized I didn't nail down that bus. And that's a long way to drive by the bus. So my wife got on the phone, and I got young, so I hopped on the bus to go over. Activity bus to Ashley Jones and got in, but that was probably one of the most embarrassing ones. I'm not about to have a bus for the team around the state.
It's persevered anyway.
I pushed every one.
And Young was the MVP. Well, we're particularly glad tonight that you got from Murphy Carey to be inducted to the North Carolina High School Athletic Baseball.
Thank you.
Coach Terrell served as a teacher and a coach from 1965 through 2004, mostly in Pitt County. He was head basketball coach at Hamlin High from 1969 to 72, advancing to the state championship three times and compiling a varsity record of 107-34. After moving from Hamlin to Farm to Central, Terrell served as assistant track and field and football coach from 75-80, helping the Jaguars to four conference championships. He served as varsity volleyball coach from 1981 to 1990, winning the conference in Atlanta. And he served as varsity tennis coach from 81 to 90 and won the conference title in 1981. But his biggest contributions came on the hardwood, where he served as Farmville Central head coach from 1973 to 1993. His teams went 355 to 118, winning three state championships and finishing as a runner-up one more time. He moved on to Troy, where he was the head basketball coach from 1994 until 2001, winning another 144 games and a conference title in 2000. During all this coaching and teaching, he still managed to serve his community, donating more than 4,000 hours of volunteer service at the Biden Medical Center. In our short video.
Specific things did you learn from those coaches that you used in your own career?
All three.
college degrees, nothing that I had. He's a head basketball coach. And he said, how about you coach my JV basketball team? I said, I don't know much about basketball. He said, be my assistant this year, and next year you come back and be my JV basketball coach. So I took over the JV basketball team, and we went on the team. We're 14-0. In fact, one of the players on that team is still Gene Tyson, 1968. So I began to like basketball. And went to a lot of coaching clinics, and I learned so much that Charlie Bishop was very outstanding coach. And of course, it's like Ripley on the short workout baseball. And they were so smooth and so quick. I said, I need to get more like those two guys. So they had a great influence in my life.
That's pretty good to start 14-0 and get over the TV program. But then you missed that first team that, you had varsity for in two games, and you considered going to coach somewhere else in the league. Could you ever envision the kind of success that you have down the road at Fall Central after that first season? What gave you hope of that?
Well, not big, but Green Central got maybe 20 points. And I was in the dressing room in the office, and coach came in and he said, your head's down, I know you don't feel good, but if you stay here and work, they will come. And they sure did.
And you didn't see those great athletes that were on the way there yet, did you?
Well, yeah.
Were they in middle school at that time? Or?
The JV team, about 2 years down the road, Dr. Patel was going to be a different group. In 1978, we had a lot of great athletes come in. The JV coach at that time, he said, well, my JV team is up to the Arctic basketball team, you can win state championship. And he did better than we did.
Pretty prophetic. Mike, I'm curious about this. If you were to describe him to a young, just starting out basketball coach like you once were, the traits you need to be successful having lived in there, what would your advice be now to a Mike Carroll who's just starting out?
Well, I think it would be important to get on a good head basketball coach, which I did. And you got to go to a lot of coaching clinics, you got to be a lot of great coaches, and you got to pick up an offense you lead in. You have to have a part of your schemes on the defense, and you have to learn throughout the year. And as you go, you work hard, you work hard.
Did you change a lot during your career, your basic schemes, or did you pretty much what you
thought? I struggled a little bit first up here as a coaching. I did like an offense. In 1983, I went to a coaching clinic. 1982, went to a coaching clinic in Wilmington. Mel Gibson was head basketball coach. He said, I've got this offense, you need to take a look at it. It's about a coaching clinic, about 25-30 coaches. He wrote up on the chalkboard. He said, this is a great offense. It follows the team, a lot of screens, a lot of movement, and it's simple. It was a simple offense, but still hard to teach. You got five guys all have to learn the same part of the offense. And so I developed a flex offense with a lot of success.
Must be a pretty good teacher with that, too. One last thing. Well, I'm going to try to say that probably is a gentleman.
You coach basketball.
Tell me something weird or unusual that you saw happen in a basketball game.
We had one game that was rain out. The gym was cut on top.
Think about that for a second. Basketball game was rain out.
A bus broke down. We had played Green Central. Bus broke down. Couldn't find a place to stop. So we stopped at an ABC store. We stayed about an hour and a half until somebody put us up.
Everybody's picturing the activity bus in the parking lot of the ABC Sports. And that's one of your coaching highlights, though. We're hoping to know is a coaching highlight. It's your name, Dallas Park, the North Carolina High School and Texas State.
Presenting the Hall of Famer. All right, at this time, I'd like to welcome to the stage Coach Jamie T.
Thank you.
Jerry, congratulations, welcome to the Sedge. When did you decide to become a coach?
I was probably a freshman at Duke College, and you know, I realized that I was smart to play hockey. And you know, I love football since I was as long as I can remember. And so I decided my freshman year for the Alabama Coach.
Did anybody influence you that you had played for? Anybody came into that decision with you?
Well, my roommate James Easy at the time, we graduated from Southern Alabama together and played for Coach Story at Southern Alabama. We were kind of going through the same thoughts, and so he got into coaching, I got into coaching, and like I said, Coach Story, my high school football coach, has been a great influence on me, not just as a player, but now since I've been coaching, and still is, and so that was a big factor in the world.
Yeah, Sam's had influence on lots of people through the years, no question about that. Riesel has a fantastic sports tradition, football against basketball particularly. Now, you mentioned some of the keys, leadership from team members, gold shoes, an important piece of that. What are other things that you think makes Reesville so competitive and so successful and over a long period of time?
Well, I think it goes back to the community. You know, the guys start out playing recreation football, and their goal is one day to put that gold hat on and just make a community statement. And so I think, you know, that's a big part of it. You know, like I said, most of the guys on staff play for Reason or knew something about Reason. I think having that sense of community is probably one of the things. And, you know, people in Reason expect to win. So, you know, just the fact that they know that they can win and they should win, I think also plays a big factor in that as well.
Now, you mentioned the importance of relationships in the video, both with your players and with your assistant coach, and that really, really stood out. And one of the things you really enjoyed about coaching. How did you, as a coach, go about developing those relationships with players? What were the most important elements to building that relationship?
Well, you know, we try to do some things with character building. We do a Tuesday night Bible study every year with the guys. And, you know, we feed them really good on those Bible studies, but we also preach the word to them too. And so, you know, we want them to have great character, and that's what we try to preach to them. And, you know, I think, again, wins and losses are important, but developing those young guys in the men is what all the coaches, that's all our goals is to develop in the men. And so we always try to do that as our number one goal.
And that kind of segues into another question. You have been active involved with Fellowship of Christian Athletes for many, many years. Can you talk a little bit about why you did that and what you gained from it and how it impacted you as a coach?
Yeah, the SCA was, I went to a SCA camp when I was in high school. Elon College. They did a thing at Elon College when I was in Southern Alabama. And, you know, it affected my life then, and I saw how important it was to the lives of young men. So, once I became a coach, I wanted to bring the SCA to wherever I was at. So we took the Fellowship of Christian Athletes and I became the advisor of the school, and then eventually when I got the Reesville, I've been the advisor for the whole county. And so I do think SCA is a great influence. One of the few places that it can influence kids still in public schools is Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And so it's been a big, very big part of my life.
Of course, that's the motto of SCA, influence people with the platform of sports. You influenced many people during your career. You won a lot of games too. You can add to that now. I'm a member of North Carolina High School Athletics and Hall of Fame. Jimmy Reed.
Before we wrap things up this evening, I'd like to apologize. I want to ask Mr. James Baldwin if he would come to the stage at this time. representing Coach Corbin, we would like to present our gift to you.
You're still here?
Sure, yeah, come on. We do have a gift that we would like to present in honor of Coach Corbin, a clock to honor his timeless legacy.
You not only have heard about it, but you now are a member of this hall. And so I am pleased to welcome this 37th class and to formally declare you as a member of the MCHSAA Hall of Fame. Congratulations. Impact in their sport and certainly are deserving of this recognition. So how did you get here? Rich Brenner, for his work behind the mic, broadcasting and telling the stories of high school teams, players, and coaches. Spike Corbin, for his efforts in molding outstanding players at a time of segregation. Players such as Alfield Gibson and Menelaw Cameron. Boyce Deeks for realizing that football can be played and won in the far west mountains of North Carolina. David Gentry, that you could find the players to not only play this game, but help you become the winningest football coach in North Carolina. Sandra Langley, for taking young women in Edgecombe County and making them winners, and as a result, becoming the winningest basketball coach in North Carolina. Nolan Nestis, finding a niche in Pantica and Martin County, coaching at some of the smallest schools in Eastern North Carolina, and winning. Jimmy Teague, for recognizing that college football is okay, but you could build a powerhouse and leave a legacy in high school football. And Mike Terrell, molding young men into winners on the basketball court while teaching and role modeling the value and importance of community service. And then the question is, how did you do it? Well, I believe you learned your ABCs at an early age. We all did. And somewhere along the way, you turned those ABCs into a motto for success. The A for attitude. That which was inside you that shaped your behavior, that you turned into a career journey. Your attitude that was determined by you. The B for belief. Along the way, you thought you could accomplish great things by teaching and coaching education-based athletics. You believed that you could sit behind that mic and tell great stories about education-based athletics. You believed it and you achieved it. And C for courage, acting in the face of fear, to accomplish those things sometimes against great odds. It has taken courage for you to go against the stronger opponents, perhaps, to believe when others around you may have been doubting. You took those three big and powerful letters, used them to make those into action words, your attitude, your belief in self, your commitment to courage, and look at where you are this evening. Thank you. And on behalf of our MCHSAA Board of Directors, and on behalf of our staff, we say to these eight individuals, two of them posthumously, we say, well done. Congratulations again. I would ask those eight individuals, those two who are representing our posthumous inductees, if you would, at this time, please make your way to those chairs to my right. Our inductees tonight. Please make your way to my right. Everybody else is going to stay seated while we do that. We will be taking pictures there. And of course, we invite you, family and friends, to join them. Let our photographer get those pictures and then you guys can do your thing. But while they're making their way over there, how about another round of applause for faith and individuals. Thank you.